Hello and welcome to our audience and welcome to this event by the Hellenic Observatory on the e-economy in Greece. The title of the event is Greece falling behind the economy, what is to be done? The event is part of our research seminar series at the Hellenic Observatory and also the public events program of the London School of Economics. The topic we're dealing with today was always important, the digital economy, the e-economy in general, but especially with the COVID pandemic, it has become increasingly important. The whole issue of digital connectivity, digital literacy has become more and more important, both for economic resilience, but also for societal, social cohesion, enabling teleworking in times of lockdown, but also facilitating social contact with self-isolating individuals, shielding individuals and other vulnerable people. To discuss this and related issues on this theme, we have three excellent speakers and experts in the field. Our first speaker is Charalambos Tsekeris. He's a research fellow at the Associate Professor rank on Digital Sociology at the National Center for Social Research in Athens. He's also academic head at the European Communication Institute and associate at the Anti-Corruption Center for Education and Research in Stellenbosch University. And his presentation is very much related to his role as principal investigator on the World Internet Project for Greece, which related to that, he's going to present some of the results of this study. Professor Tsekeris has authored more than 100 scholarly papers, and edited a number of books. His current research involves the dynamics of digital society and economy in Greece, and this is very much the topic of our theme today. Together with Professor Tsekeris, we have Ms. Effie Bitrou and Professor Calliope, Spanou as the discussants, who will also contribute to the discussion today. Effie Bitrou is head of digital banking at the National Bank of Greece, and she is responsible for the growth and development of NBG's digital offering. Before joining the National Bank of Greece, she held the position as vice president at JP Morgan's asset management in London and was responsible for digital transformation programs in Europe and Asia. Prior to that, she was manager with Accenture in the UK, working in the systems integration practice for retail and banking. She holds a bachelor's degree in electrical and computer engineering from the National University of Athens, and a master's degree in information systems management from our very own London School of Economics. Our second discussant, Professor Calliope Spanou, is professor of administrative science and public administration at the National Kapodistrian University of Athens in the Department of Political Science and Public Administration. She was elected by a committee at the Hellenic Parliament and served as Greek ombudsman in 2011-2015. While she had also served previously as deputy ombudsman before in 2003-2011. Professor Spanou has extensive experience regarding administrative reform, and among others, she has cooperated with the OECD as an expert regarding public administration reform in a number of countries. Her research interests cover issues of public administration, public policy, citizen administration relations, Europeanization, and others. She has published numerous books and articles, not only in Greek and English, but also in French. So before I pass the floor to our speakers, let me make a couple of quick announcements. For those using the Twitter in the audience, the hashtag for the event today is hashtag LSE Greece. And the event is, this an online event is being recorded and hopefully will be made available as a podcast, hopefully if we don't have any technical difficulties. At the end of the presentations, there will be plenty of time for questions and answers with the audience. To submit your questions, please use the Q&A feature at the bottom of your screen. Questions will be submitted to myself, and I will ask the questions or as many questions as possible to our speakers to facilitate the discussion. For those watching the event live on Facebook, please add your comments, your questions as comments, and there will be we will take note of them and put them into the discussion as well. Okay, so that's it for me. We're very much looking for the presentation by Professor Tsekeris, but also the discussion about the digital economy in Greece. Professor Tsekeris, the floor is yours.
Well, hope you can see that. Many thanks, dear Vassilis, and I would like to thank the Hellenic Observatory, on behalf of the National Center for Social Research, Athens, Greece. I'm going to talk about the Greek digital economy and the Greek digital society in some extent, drawing from the World Internet Project. Well, let me firstly sketch the global context very briefly. It is characterized by Industry 4 and Globalization 4, which raise questions about the future of democracy and the future of work, and there are major shifts in economic structure and governance. COVID-19, as you said, Vassilis, is a major catalyst. It is a catalyst for digitalization. It has accelerated hyperconnectivity and has shown the fragility of key infrastructures and poses the need for resilience. The European context is characterized by digital single market, which is an incomplete policy belonging to the European single market that covers digital marketing, e-commerce, and telecommunications. The Greek context, the Greek digital context, is characterized by low level of digital social cohesion. There are many surveys showing that, and a high level of digital inequality among regions, sectors, firms, gender in the field of ICT professionals, workers, and generations. We score one of the highest levels of intergenerational digital divide. This is the Digital Maturity Index by the Hellenic Federation of Greek Enterprises. Well, this is the previous year's one. This year's Digital Maturity Index shows that we score higher in the digital maturity of the public sector, but we score very low. We are in the lowest position in the digital maturity of the Greek enterprises and the Greek society in general. COVID-19 crisis has increased socioeconomic inequalities at global level. And we score low again in the IMD digital the IMD digital competitiveness index. Well, as far as the World Internet Project is concerned, it was founded in 1999. It is based on South California Annenberg School Center for the Digital Future. The World Internet Project is a major international collaborative project looking at the social, political, and economic impact of internet and other new technologies. The National Center for Social Research is the Greek participation in the World Internet Project, and we are now doing an ongoing research to update it to include the pandemic, to show how the pandemic act as a huge accelerator for digital reform in Greece and highlights the importance for digital infrastructure and digital human and social capital for inclusive and adaptive resilient recovery. But the World Internet Project report that we conducted, the survey that we conducted last year, has valuable results and has anticipated in some way the coronavirus disruption of the Greek digital society. This is an extract from the paper that is going to get published in Hellenic Observatory Discussion Paper Series. Greece appears as a digitally immature, unready, and vulnerable society with strong antinomies and contradictions. Indeed, we saw long queues outside bank stores. We saw the unpreparedness of the digital education system. We saw lack of skills, lack of access, lack of infrastructure. We saw lack of preparedness in the field of Greek enterprises. No more than 10% of the Greek enterprises are fully digitalized. So, as far as the internet use is concerned, the internet is mostly used by younger, employed, and better educated population of Greece and of higher income. The population is growing. Over 70% of the population is using the internet, but we have a high number of non-users, almost 30%, and we have, and 70% of them are dynamic non-users. That is, they are determined not to use the internet in the future. So there is a significant digital gap. And the digital divide also exists in geographical terms. There's a gap between urban and rural areas. Attica, Crete, and South Aegean are champions in the use of the internet. We have low diversity of online activities. We use it mostly for communication, entertainment, watching videos, listening to music, for online news consumption. We are champions in online news consumption. And we don't use it much for learning purposes and for creative and innovative purposes. But we are not scoring low in social media presentation. We are mature social media users. Focus by YouGov joint research has updated this info. April 2020, we are doing well in the use of social media. But as I said before, we are not using the internet in a creative manner to do business, to do online transactions, to buy online, to sell online, to do e-booking, to do online payments, or to invest online. So we need digital financial literacy. Low diversity is also shown by the OECD's House Life in the Digital Age report. And low diversity is combined with weak demand for internet services. The bonding social capital in the digital world, that is connecting with friends and family, is much stronger than bridging or linking social capital. That is, we do not use the internet so much for connecting with society in general, civil society, to connect with government or the state or public services. Greek users are also highly skeptical regarding the reliability of online information. But paradoxically, they have the impression that they can control the reliability of online information and fake news on the net. Most of them say they have nothing to hide. The majority is actively protecting their privacy online and express strong concerns about privacy violations, mostly by corporations. The majority also do not expect that online participation will increase their ability to influence government decisions or that public officials will be more interested in their opinion. So we have a low level of digital political trust. I will not elaborate on the Digital Economy and Society Index because these are well-known data. We have this significant figure of digital public services, which is getting higher, but we still remain among the biggest. This is also shown by the e-government development index and the digital government index by OECD. The digitalization of public services is accelerated now by the portal YouGov of the Ministry of Digital Governance, providing more than 700 e-services. The ministry helps teleworking, teleconferencing, these processes are here to stay because they're more sustainable, economically and technologically and environmentally sustainable. So the thing is that to create an overall framework for transparency on the net, a framework of trust and public support for digitalization, and to give power to the people, that is to empower citizens in a bottom-up way. As far as the Greek businesses is concerned, we score lower than the previous year. The use of cloud services and small and medium enterprises selling online are Greek businesses' weakest digital dimensions. So digital skills and digital human capital is the most important and most difficult part of the DESI index. We still score low, albeit good efforts by the Greek government. There is a cultural aspect here. We need to confront phobic and defensive cultural attitudes toward democracy, toward technology, innovation, and the future. Greece has been a digital laggard because of its model of productivity, because of its essential characteristics of its productivity base. So we're trying to boost digital skills by the Digital Skills and Jobs Coalition, by the Digital Citizen Academy. We need critical digital skills in order to break filter bubbles and echo chamber, because in some extent we are an echo chamber society. Critical digital skills to tackle digital challenges like attention economy, choices of architecture, algorithmic content curation and disinformation. We have to catch up the train of digital, of skills revolution, the train of reskilling and upskilling by building digital intelligence at individual, corporate, collective, societal level. Digital intelligence is the sum of social, emotional, cognitive abilities that enable individuals to face and communities to face the challenges of and adapt to demands of digital life based on community values. And we also have to build the ethical and ethical digital ecosystem as a collective responsibility. We also have to fit the world's first global standards for digital literacy, digital skills, and digital readiness. And finally, we have to catch up the train of globalization for the COVID 19 pandemic slows the so-called globalization 3, but speeds up, slows down globalization 3, but speeds up globalization 4. Globalization 4 is this condition of interconnectedness between virtual and digital systems, provoking the diffusion of services, innovation, knowledge, and information. This is the globotics upheaval. So we need to adjust into this kind of globalization as a society. And we need to create structures of adaptation as a society. We fear, we are afraid of job automation. We also afraid of robots that will take our jobs. This is the most recent survey from McKinsey. And there is a substantive risk of job automation shown by the OECD report. So what do we have to do? We have to build digital human capital, digital social capital, digital trust, digital cohesion. We have to also build digital inclusive institutional capital in order to deliver in order to create a sustainable, agile, and resilient digital future. Some further recommendations include further simplification of administrative procedures by ensuring interoperability amongst all platforms. Public administration must open all non-personal anonymous data, and public and private sectors collaboration is needed in upgrading, exploiting digital infrastructure and technology. We need more competition policies and more digital innovation hubs covering all economic sectors. Blockchain and cryptocurrency research is of utmost importance nowadays. We also need an overall comprehensive national plan for investments in Industry 4. Local government must leverage smart city technologies, and we need to adapt our current innovation model of manufacturing. Media multi-literacies should be diffused. We also need to institutionalize fact-checking. And we need better regulation and techno-ethics, mostly AI ethics, and to build a framework of digital policies, of data policy, digital trust, digital inclusion and cohesion in order to combine innovation, responsibility, and trust. And also in order to meet UN Sustainable Development Goals. Finally, we need foresight policies. That is, we need to build future narratives. We need to plan our future. And we need to prepare for our future by focusing on policy areas that will provoke progress, environmental, societal, economic progress. Economy is a megatrend with positive features like anti-fragility. Anti-fragility is the reason that we have to speed up e-economy within COVID environment and within very risky environment. But there are negative dimensions like economic polarization, labor polarization, cyber threats. These tendencies, these threats, are also highlighted by the Strategic Foresight Report of the European Commission, which is charting the course towards a more resilient Europe. And we have to contribute to this foresight debate. We have to advise from this mapping of structural, to get advice from this mapping of structural risks facing the EU. We have to fully exploit the recovery plan for Europe, and we need a twinning of the digital and green transition and cooperation between stakeholders of the industry and of the state to tackle industry for challenges and globalization for challenges. So the journey of digital Greek economy is just beginning, but we don't have time. We have to speed up. I don't have time as well. My presentation is finished. Thank you for listening.
Thank you. Thank you, Charalambos. That's very interesting. And there was a lot of material in the presentation, and I think many points to come back. But you definitely mentioned fragility and how the digital economy can sort of provide more resilience, less fragility, but also the problems of polarization. So two discussions are perfectly suited, I think, to speak on those issues. I'll pass the floor directly to Effie Bitrou.
Good evening from me as well. I would like, first of all, to congratulate the organizers and the Hellenic Observatory for this series of online events. Thank you very much for inviting me. As an LSE alumna, I'm particularly excited to return to the LSE campus, even in a virtual setting, and share the digital floor with distinguished speakers. I'm pretty sure we'll be having a very thought-provoking discussion later on all together. In listening to Professor Tsekeris, I am in vast agreement with most of his comments, and I would like to expand on some of the points he made. When we speak about digital maturity in Greece, especially in challenging and unpredictable times like the ones we're in, we need to take into account that it's a particularly complex topic specifically someone that is not so close to the Greek context needs to see from various angles and take a more multifaceted approach. I will start by giving an overview of the state of the Greek society and how that it was only several months ago in the pre-COVID era. As Dr. Tsekeris said, Greece has a higher percentage of well-trained and higher education graduates in the fields related to digital transformation, like the STEM fields. However, the country's performance in terms of digital skills in business and society scores quite low and is not at satisfactory levels at large. Again, digital usage services from a high levels point of view, appear to be on par with the rest of the EU average. Having said that, by taking a closer look, we can see that digital services, adoption of digital services scores quite high when it comes to leisure and entertainment activities, such as holiday planning, Expedia, TripAdvisor, Booking.com, social media usage, and news and content consumption through popular platforms like YouTube and Netflix. Now, the Greeks' adoption of digital, of core digital services like e-government, e-shopping, or e-banking still significantly lags behind compared to the EU average. And that in particular to me highlights two very interesting points. The first one is a digital divide amongst different demographics, which is inevitably fueled as well by the inequalities that got deepened by the recent profound 10-year economic crisis. For instance, Greek women, even younger women, aged between 18 and 35 years old, score low on digital skills and digital use compared to their male counterparts in the same age group. Now, the second one, and probably the most interesting point to take into account, is the varying levels of digital maturity across different Greek demographics. The lack of information that the average Greek has on web and mobile use, but also the inherent risks that they are not so familiar with, are obstacles to the further penetration of internet use in the wider population, and not so much only for consumers, but business alike. To prove my point, I would like to share some facts from the digital banking ecosystem, which I happen to be, the Greek digital banking ecosystem, which I happen to be part of. Over the recent pandemic, especially during the first lockdown, we've seen a radical shift in perception and explosion of e-banking transactions, as well as card payments and mobile wallet payments. That was pretty much in line with the global trend we've seen in other countries due to the COVID effect. However, we've also witnessed a disproportionately higher percentage of successful phishing scam attacks that were particularly targeted to more vulnerable and less tech-savvy demographics. It is shocking to me the number of incidents we see daily of the average consumers that give away extremely sensitive data like card details, phone numbers, e-banking credentials to unauthorized sources. This gets us to a downward spiral as major fraud incidents are making to the headlines, and this further intimidates the non-digital native demographics and further slow down the effective adoption of digital services for the wider population. Why is that then? That's the question that comes to everyone's mind. And according to Dr. Tsekeris, he touched upon a number of these points. I will just expand a little bit more on some of those. I think the most prominent one is the fact that Greece lacks and traditionally hasn't had a national plan for the country's digital transformation. Greece significantly lags behind in creating a favorable environment for digital transformation, and the inherent weaknesses of the Greek society, such as the lack of continuity in public administration, the high administrative as well as bureaucratic burden, the unclear, if existent, legal and regulatory framework, as well as the slow delivery of justice in certain cases, contribute to this equation. We also need to acknowledge the role played by the high cost, as well as poor coverage of broadband services, as well as the inexistence up until very recently of very fundamental prerequisites for digital transformation, like the electronic ID, the EID, e-contracts, and all these sort of concepts. We have to be fair though, and acknowledge that this has changed dramatically over the past months. COVID-19 has proved a unique opportunity to accelerate long overdue developments in the innovation and digital transformation arena that happened not only with months, but also within weeks. From a public administration standpoint, as we've seen earlier on, we have the launch of GovGR, a new initiative that, for those unfamiliar with the Greek society, it's a new initiative that aspires to be a one-stop shop for every citizen's interaction with public services, with any public services. And that can be from paying his taxes all the way to online medication prescription. In the following weeks, we will also see the launch of eKYC, Know Your Customer platform. And that's the new government platform that enables all Greek citizens to manage centrally in real time their personal and sensitive data. And not only that, but also manage the way this is shared across. For example, in Greece today, someone even for applying for something as simple as a credit card to a bank, he needs to share fully his own, as well as his spouse's financial details through the tax statement. Now, through the eKYC platform, that can be automated and the citizen can have full control on the level of detail that is passed on to the bank. That all is very promising, and although inevitably there is a lot of things for Greece to catch up, I feel that Greece needs to resist the temptation to push for digital transformation as an afterthought at the back of the global pandemic. I feel this is an opportunity to rather pursue this digital transformation as a strategic priority. This means that Greece has to define a vision, a strategy, as well as a national plan to get there. I've read very recently an interview by Microsoft CEO Satya Nadella, where he recognized three phases in the post-COVID era. He says that the first phase, the phase we're currently in, this is the response phase. And this is where we are trying to respond with traditional crisis management techniques to the challenges that we have ahead of us. The second phase that we are slowly moving also in Greece and in Europe is the recovery. This is where we take the innovation and emergency solutions that were born out of necessity in the previous phase and take them to standardization and industrialization. In simple terms, we make them part of our everyday life and we make them business as usual. And in the third phase, that hopefully Greece will be in the next 18 to 24 months, this is the reimagination. This is much more than the sum of the previous two phases. It's much more than just taking efficiencies and incorporate them in the existing processes. It is much more than digitalizing previously offline processes. It's more about rethinking the financial model in Greece and aiming towards a drastic reorientation of this model by having an economy that is favorable of the gig economy, that embraces high-tech private investment, and eventually leads to the democratization of a digital transformation for the entire set of its citizens. Now, wrapping up my commentary, I would like to go back to today's question, whether Greece falls behind in the e-economy. I think that the answer lies in the question itself. The moment we start separating the e-economy from the traditional economy or from the rest of the economy, it becomes obvious that there is a very hard line between the offline and the online world, the digital and the rest. I'm very much hopeful that in the following months, we will not have this strict separation, and hopefully the answer will be very different to the answer we will give today. Thank you very much, everyone, for your participation and attention. And I'm looking forward to the questions at the Q&A session.
Thank you. Thank you, Effie. Indeed, one day maybe we'll not separate between digital and non-digital, but I think we're quite some way far. I also like to comment the what you said about the post-COVID era. It's the first time I hear something about post-COVID era. I think it's also going to be a while in, you know, we're going to be a while in the COVID era. But a number of very important things that were also raised in your comments. We can pick all this up in the discussion later, but for now I'll pass the floor to Calliope Spanou.
Thank you very much, and thank you for this invitation. So much has been already said and raised that it is very difficult for me to readjust a little bit my ideas. The study has highlighted many aspects, although in my view there is a lot to dig into still in order to have a better view of the causes of this delay of Greece and the more delicate aspects of that. In any case, digitalization is to a large extent the driver of globalization today, and all kinds, from economic to cultural. These forces are much stronger than in the past, I think, because globalization had different forms. But as you all know, this kind of revolutions, in this case, the fourth industrial revolution, does not take place simultaneously in all countries and at the same speed throughout society. So we have to accept that this process cannot be evenly distributed within societies and economies and countries. Now, I belong to a generation that had this experience of the digital technologies during my adulthood. And I think that my generation may be seen as, the absolute case study of adjustment to this. We found it on our way and we follow it. But how far we go with it, it's still an open question. Younger generations are much more familiar with it. They were born with a mobile phone or a computer in their hands. So it's something that is in many ways a natural consequence. I understand, and I would like to come to the aspect of the different attitudes towards the digitalization. As the study has showed, there is about 30% of the population that seems to be, not a user, and sometimes, rather resistant to the use of the internet and digital technologies. However, if you go into the specifics of that, you see that it concerns more women than men, more those who are not in active employment than those who are in active employment, more to older generations than younger people. So this is a clear reminder that the kind of digital illiteracy has a sociological rather than technological components. So whatever action plan is to be in some way devised, we need to address these issues. For example, is it also because there is still a much more traditional view of women's role in society that explains this gender gap? Or is it the fact that those who are in employment and during the past 10 years, we had a very high rate of unemployment. Those who are not in active employment cannot keep up with these transformations, challenges, and also requirements, because the labor market may require these skills. But those who are out of this, of the labor market, cannot participate in kind of upskilling of training and getting, you know, more familiar and more skilled in terms of digital technology. So I would be very much interested in a more sociological explanation of these divides. Who are these people? Who are these people who are 30% of the population? Where do they live? What is their age? What might be, and that's a question that we need to ask, what might be the basic and necessary uses of the internet for them? So internet is not everything for everyone. It's the needs of specific groups of the population and groups based on different criteria. So, another question is, how possible is it to bring them into the digital world? I am not very optimistic about that. At the end of the day, there are certain aspects that are not necessarily that are not covered by this digitalization. Now imagine someone unemployed who is theoretically empowered by having to interact digitally with an employment advisor. I don't think that would be the proper way. And that would also not be the proper way for the person who is unemployed. So we need to diversify our perspective. Who needs what, how, under what circumstances, and how much this digital infrastructure we have in mind can serve these purposes, can serve these special groups in the population. Another issue is trust. It has been mentioned before. Trust is appears to be very contradictory. While people, as it was mentioned before, give away a lot of their data, at the same time they think that the internet is not safe. There's no security. Now this is a contradictory behavior, but that may also mean something more than that. Just that. Why do they give their data? And are they? What do they mean by saying that the internet is not fully secure? For me, this study that I read and was presented today, along with many others, opens up many more questions than it answers. And I would like to have more about that. Another issue I will mention, and I think I will try to sum up with that, is the state-citizen divide. We know very well that in Greece, trust between the citizen and the state is not really, you know, the most marking feature, to say the least. The state does not trust the citizen, and in that sense, it always increases bureaucracy and procedures and controls and this and that. And the citizen does not trust the state because the state, it is, you know, citizens think that the state's always after them by considering them as always untrustworthy and all of that. So we have a mutual suspicion that does not help in the development of the digitalization of public services. Now, What is interesting, however, is that we have a lot of progress in that area, and with COVID-19, this has increased, and that's absolutely marvelous. And you know, it's a big achievement within a very short amount of time. But let me give you another example. Why some time ago it was you should go to the tax office in order to get the codes, the tax codes. This is not anymore the case after, you know, COVID-19. This is the question of trust. This is the question of trust. And it seems that with COVID-19, we have overcome also a kind of trust divide. To what extent, I'm not sure yet, but because it may happen that once we're in the post-COVID era, as you said before, all this goes back to person to person, you know, to interpersonal contact. Let's see. And the last point I would like to make is that we all know that TaxisNet was one of the major advancements, major achievements in the past decades. This digitalization started from taxation. And to the point that today it's the most reliable infrastructure, the most reliable system in order to do anything else with regard to the, you know, public services. You need tax codes, and you use in fact this infrastructure of TaxisNet. Why did it start? Why did it start from there? It's more or less an obvious question, an obvious answer. But still, that shows that progress, yes, Greece may appear a laggard, but I would say that progress is more uneven. It's not just lagging behind. It's an uneven progress. And at the end of the day, the motto of the Greek policy approach, to digitalization seems to me to be, give me a reason. Give me a reason, and then this works as an accelerator, overcoming resistance, hesitations, and generally low ambitions and expectations. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Calliope. I think you made a reference to Tracy Chapman there at the end with "Give Me a Reason." Again, a number of issues. I think it would be useful if I passed on the floor to Professor Tsekeris to make a few comments. But obviously, you cannot relate Harry to all points raised. But I would like to hear your comments, particularly on this, the first of the points that Calliope made about the sociological versus technological reasons underpinning the low absorption, low take-up of internet services in Greece. Also in relation to what Effie was saying then, and back to that issue of trust and the very high incidence of phishing. So, one, whether we're talking about sort of technology that can cure the different problems and give access to people, versus kind of the you know, cultural and sociological characteristics, including the demographics of the people not using the internet, but also if these two factors also affect the relations of trust and the problems that may arise through scamming, phishing, and so forth on the digital platforms.
Okay, just let me briefly reflect on the demographics of the non-users. I have to say that our approach in the World Internet Project is interdisciplinary and mostly sociological, but interdisciplinary and transdisciplinary in order to understand this vast complexity of the internet. So the demographics of the non-users is the non-user, the typical internet non-user is female, 60 plus years old, without college degree, no college degree, and retired, and we don't, living in the rural, living in Attica area. So female, 60 plus, no college degree, windowed, retired, living in Attica. This is also the demographics of the dynamical non-users. Well, what is the reason for not using the internet? There are many reasons, but mainly the reasons do not have to do with lack of access or lack of infrastructure. Of course, the internet in Greece is relatively expensive. We have an expensive internet and also a slow internet. So it is not value for money. But the main reason of this population, of this 30%, for not using the internet is that they think that it is not useful. It is confusing them. They don't trust the internet. These are the main reasons. So the reasons are mostly cultural rather than technological. That's why we have to build digital trust. We have to build up positive narratives for the digital society and for our digital future. As Acemoglu says, we have to invest on new technologies as much as on education and social cohesion. If we do not invest on education and social cohesion, the result will be a polarized, a highly polarized society with high level of populism and high level of extremism. As Professor Pissarides has said, and also Englehart, Ronald Englehart has said, that the problem is not so much technological unemployment. Of course, this is a problem because there is a huge mismatch, as Effie said, a huge mismatch between education and labor market, between skills and the labor market, between degrees and the labor market. But public policies may create an ecosystem of skills in order to decrease this technological unemployment. The biggest risk is not technological unemployment. The biggest risk is technological inequality and the perception of technological inequality, as Englehart says. The perception of inequality is the reason of the increase in populism and extremism. So of this dissolution of Aristotle's middle ground. So we live in a new economy that is digital economy. We live in a new society that is digital society. And the only way to deal with that is to build human capital, digital human capital, digital social capital, and digital institutional capital. Regulation must rebuild trust to the system. And we have to focus on cultural factors, the so-called underdog culture. We are afraid of the future. We are afraid of the digital future. We fear of job automation. We have to build, that's why I said before, we have to build positive narratives for our digital future. And this is the point, that This is the point of the so-called complexity paradox. This evolution creates more questions and dilemmas than answers. And our research generates more questions than answers. I think that we need a better governance and better cooperation at European and international level. Europe is doing many things to regulate the digital future, and we have to participate in this debate about regulation, about foresight, about digital social cohesion and digital trust, and we have to create responsive innovation. We need faster innovation because we are a laggard in innovation, in any innovation index, but we need also sustainable, responsible innovation in order to create a cohesive, smart, and inclusive digital society and a human-centered digital future for all citizens.
Thank you, Harry. I think I need to open the. I have a number of questions that I want to ask also in relation to the user versus skilled human capital employee and entrepreneur and so forth. But we need to open up the floor. We already have a number of questions from the audience. Can I just say to the people who are preparing to ask the questions that please try to type short questions? I spent the last 6-7 minutes reading one of the questions. Short questions in the Q&A box at the bottom of your screen. We will, of course, try to discuss all of them or as many as possible. And please try to include your name and affiliation so that we know where you are, who you are. And, it will make the discussion better. Also, people write questions on the Facebook. Please try to share your location so that we can also know something about you. So I would like to privilege one of our Hellenic Conservative people, Professor Featherstone, has asked this question, which relates to one of the points that you picked up on, Harry. And he was saying that Papandreou favored e-governance as a way also of, obviously for transparency, but also to build trust in government institutions. To an extent, we're still in the same direction of travel. But Kevin asks that suggests that this reversed the causation, that if you have trust, then you go to use e-governance services rather than the availability of e-governance services would create trust. And the question is, how much more can we expect from pursuing the same logic of asking for e-governance and infrastructure from the public administration in order to build something that is not there in the first place? I would like to address the question actually to everybody in the panel. Maybe Calliope would also like to say something. But Harry.
Yeah, Calliope, may I answer first, please?
Should I answer? I agree with the question in the sense of what is missing often is something that technology cannot offer, and this is trust. Trust in these matters is not only trust in the technology and how secure it is and all of that, but also trust in the relationship that is supposed to be created through this digital infrastructure. I believe that they should go together in some way, but the fact that this trust does not exist already does not make things easier. So I also, in many ways, I have the same question like Professor Featherstone. And Harris can possibly give more about it.
I fully agree with the question and with your answer, dear Calliope. I think that there is a mutual reinforcement between online trust and offline trust. Greek citizens traditionally, we do not trust the state. Although in this COVID-19 condition, there are signs of confidence, not trust, but confidence toward the state. So this is a good step, but we need to build a whole framework of transparency, reliability, a whole framework mobilizing the citizens to become engaged, informed, participatory digital citizens. We cannot expect a developed digital economy and digital society without engaged, educated, informed, and active digital citizens. So that's why we need to focus on new digital citizenship narrative, new narratives that will create alternative futures. This is a matter of education, and cohesion will create more trust. So trust is at stake, and we have to build a more resilient economy, a more inclusive economy, a new ecosystem of skills that are not only technological or technical skills, but there are skills, there are creative skills, future skills, skills for communication online, for building online networks, for coordinating digital networks, etc. Skills is a key factor for moving forward, both hard skills and soft skills, and we need to do it fast, because in 2 years from now, current skills need will be out of date. So we need an ecosystem of skills that will be continually get updated and will be inclusive. Artificial intelligence, 5G technologies, and Internet of Things creates the so-called post-internet future. We have questions about citizenship, identity at many levels. All these things are at stake. That's why literacy, futures literacy, is combined with digital literacy. We have to embrace the future, embrace change, embrace uncertainty, embrace complexity. These are cultural skills, mostly. And we have to focus on this skill set in this new ecosystem.
I would like to bring Effie also into the question, but Harry, you mentioned skills, and there's a question that is being addressed to Effie, so I will add this in the discussion that Effie can do. So Stratos Neromiliotis asks whether to which degree the modern Greek education system introduces students, prepares students for the current digital world, and how the Greek universities in particular encourage the use of practical digital tools to prepare for the new global economy. So, because also Harry mentioned that the idea that, you know, we need more skills, and skills get depleted very fast in a world. So is the university doing anything in that, and to what extent, what is the scope for university to do that? But also, if you want to relate to the previous question.
I would like to the previous question on the trust. I think it's trust. It's of monumental importance when it comes to digital interaction, especially with the state or with the banking system. And back to the original point about trust and whether people will revert to the offline processes once the COVID pandemic is over. I can only bring the examples we have from the Greek banking system. First with capital controls, and now with the COVID, we've seen an explosion in digital banking. After the capital controls, we didn't see a reduction in the number of digital banking users or in the transactions. On the opposite, we've seen a very steep increase. Also in the recent pandemic, although at the end of the lockdown, we had like 90% being completed in the digital channels, in June, when branches were opened and the restrictions have been lifted, we've seen 92%. So my point is, when there is trust and there is convenience and the customer experience is much more superior to the offline world, it's a no-brainer. It will be very hard to go back to the old way of doing things. As long as you have trust and the comfort that, you know, your money is sent to the person that needs to receive it, your tax is paid, you get your meds because you have the prescription on your smartphone, et cetera, et cetera. So I think that's probably my kind of take based on my experience in the banking system, which happens to be very similar. It's an industry that has a lot of similarities when it comes to the governance. On the university and the whole educational, how the Greek education system prepares new young citizens for digital transformation and if there is a plan, I think in my experience as someone that has been educated in Greece and in the UK, but as well as a digital practitioner in Greece, as I said earlier, I think we are lacking a plan, a national plan on how different stages, different industries will lead citizens through this digital enlightenment, if you like. So apart from ad hoc efforts that may happen on a particular university, I don't think there's a well orchestrated system in that respect. To Professor Tsekeris' point, I wouldn't expect the universities or the education system to teach digital cybersecurity or basic digital understanding concepts. I would expect them to teach them the ongoing learning and evolution skill, how to keep themselves constantly updated, how to educate themselves on new technologies, on new skills, rather than teach them technology XYZ, which by the time they need to use it, probably it's going to be out of date. So that's where I see the major contribution that not just the Greek, but every educational system needs to play in this new world. There is a summit in Greece taking place these days, which has a very bold title. It's called Unlearn. And I think that's basically the new skill we need to, our educational system in Greece needs to invest on, is how to unlearn probably the old traditional ways and relearn how to be flexible, nimble, and agile, more than anything.
We're still on the process of learning rather than the process of unlearning. I would like to pick up on this point. So in a different world, in more kind of labor economics things, not directly related to the question of digitalization, although that is also a field and an area that is looked at also in labor economics, of course. But there is this kind of understanding of, if you want, a division of labor where you get more, hopefully soft skills, but also generic skills from the education system. But you rely on different forms of the employment relationship and how it links to the education system to develop specific skills. So if you want the kind of the German apprenticeship model where, there's combined education and placement, or something which is more, in the world of internships and other placements outside education. And of course, we know that the skills needed for the robotization, digitalization era are very fast changing. So that would suggest that employers have to do most of the legwork in terms of upskilling and training and continuously training the workers. But then we know that employers in Greece are few large employers and many small, very small micro businesses who, even if they wanted to, even if they were themselves very literate in digital terms, they wouldn't be able to necessarily support the cost of training. They don't even have employees, let alone to train them, for example. So do you think, and again, a question for the whole of the panel, do you think that is a fundamental problem in Greece, which is qualitatively different than in other places in Europe? So we have a problem in terms of the supply of skills just because of the structure of the economy. So I don't know if you can start, and then I would like to hear the views of the rest of the panel as well.
I think it's an interesting one. I think we have to take into account that Greece is a relatively small market. The economy is in the process of recovering from a very long fiscal crisis. The investments, the budgets have been reduced for companies of all sizes, and especially budget on development, or on talent development, have been in many cases acts like a frill, which is obviously, I don't think we believe this is in the right direction. So we do start from a rather not advantaged position. I think that that's something we have to acknowledge. Having said that, I think we are fortunate enough to be in 2020, which is a year that leapfrog is possible. I feel that I think it's more that the problem these days is not so much the budget. I think it's more of the mindset that needs to change on the employment arena, in the Greek market. I feel that the saying that goes like, if there is a will, there is a way, I think it couldn't be more true for year 2020, that you can find. Thankfully, because of technology, you can find solutions that you can develop your employees, you can invest in an ongoing manner on the upskilling, reskilling. So I feel that it's more a matter of top management understanding and assessing the importance of keeping their employees up to speed, rather than the actual economic or technological barriers that may exist in the process.
Mm-hmm. Thanks, Effie. Calliope, would you like to say something?
Can you hear me? Okay.
Yeah.
Yes, I think the structure of the economy is an important factor, but I would like to stress another aspect of training. We need training anyway in order to increase the so-called employability, which means that after such a protracted crisis and high unemployment rates, there are people long-term unemployed who have probably lost touch with, you know, developments and lost interest, maybe even worse. So one thing, yes, it is training, but in connection to employment. The second point is that those who mostly fear automation, that's a point that was referred a few moments ago, are mostly unskilled people, people who can easily be replaced by, you know, machines, robots, whatever. And there we need to see what is the percentage, how big is this group? It could be a big group. And sometimes they're also long-term unemployed. So that makes the problem even worse. And the last is that there are people who are outside of the economy and will never go back in. And I fear that those who are outside, who are not in active employment, have no interest or no chance or no hope or no whatever to go back into employment. They're outside of all these policies. It's a matter of personal motivation to get more literate in terms of digital technologies. This female 60 plus widow, etc. Why should she do it? Maybe Facebook, in order to communicate with her grandchildren or one of her friends. But what else? E-banking, yes, e-banking is something that they may learn. I'm not sure. I have the feeling that there is a group that is in that way more or less lost. It has lost the train, had missed the train, has lost the opportunity and missed the train. So, and in that respect, I'm not sure that this should be, you know, the target group for a strategy for the digitalization and training and all of that.
I would like to bring in a question that links to the demographic, a question by George Daremas from Athens. I think he says, the younger generation appears adept at digital use, but it is rather ignorant of how the digital ecosystem operates. And this shows both in the low level of cybersecurity, but even more significantly in the high degree of digital addiction, which is the second largest in Europe after the UK. Maybe the problem with internet penetration and digitalization is not so much, as Calliope was saying, the group that have opted out, in their own accord, but is with the new young generations that are not actually getting safely, both in terms of cybersecurity, but also in terms of digital addiction into the digital world. Can I start from Charalambos and then we go the other direction for the panel?
Yes, indeed. I have seen some surveys. I have recently seen a survey showing that Greece is in the top three of the European countries with problems of internet addictions. We score high in internet addiction. I have in mind some surveys showing that we score high at Thessaly and at some Aegean islands. And the thing is that we have a high level of internet addiction in teenagers. So the solution to this problem can be described by the concept of digital intelligence. I mean, we have children and teenagers, especially in non-urban area, that do not use creatively the internet, and they are the so-called internet natives, digital natives. They do not reflect critically on the net, but they do not have mentors to show them the way. I mean, the problem exists not only in the teenage population, but in the population of the teachers, in the population of the parents. Digital intelligence has to do with, that's why I focused on this term, and there are global standards of digital intelligence now. Digital intelligence is a huge set of competencies. It is not just one intelligence, it is many kinds of intelligence. So it is a building online identity, it is communicating online and offline, is a work-life balance. Online is about protecting your life, cybersecurity, cyber safety, etc. This should be applied also to collective, community, collective and societal level. For example, we should think about digital intelligence at national and European level. The cyber resilience of Europe in this pandemic is almost to the limit. That is, cyber resilience is the biggest issue because digital economy is very vulnerable to cyber threats, to cyber viruses, crypto assets and knowledge economy and the economy of networks is good because it gives huge dynamics, but there are many weaknesses in terms of security, safety, both at collective and individual level. Addiction is also a social issue. It has social origins. It is not just a psychological issue. We should avoid psychologization of addiction. It is a whole mindset, as Effie said, the whole mindset of using the internet, of utilizing digital resources, and this should be cultivated by an ecosystem of skills, knowledge, and I can say digital practical wisdom that is the Aristotelian phronesis. We need digital phronesis in order to create a new condition that marries, that creates a happy marriage between cognitive capitalism and democracy. This immaterial economy, this economy of intangible products, services, and goods is full of promises, but is also full of dangers, and public policies should be applied to protect the citizens, the consumers, the producers, the industry, and regulation is also needed, a coordinated regulation level, a regulation system at European level to protect the future. Regulation is of utmost importance in the way toward AI society.
Yeah, thanks, Harry. So Calliope, regulation and public policy to protect vulnerable users of the internet?
Yes, we need it, but we know that regulation cannot prevent this kind of problems, cannot be 100% effective. Often regulation works in reverse when you want to see what went wrong and who is responsible. But in terms of preventing, regulation runs, you know, always behind developments. It's not something that is in the front, you know, it's a front runner. It's, I think, just follows, tries to follow, but is never as fast as developments.
Yeah. Effie, on the same issue about youth, obviously in the banking sector, it must be that young people use e-banking services and e-wallets and things much more than people of my age. Do you think there's more exposure to cyber security threats for younger people, exactly in the line of the question that we had, because of less appreciation of the whole ecosystem?
Mm-hmm. I think I have to say I feel relieved listening to Professor Tsekeris and Professor Spanou. I feel that this is a trend much broader than what the trends we see in the digital banking space in Greece. And I think it ties back to the digital the level of digital literacy and maturity of the population. It is very uneven. I think it's very clear. I think we do see when it comes to digital banking use, we do see a lot of males who typically tend to be more in control of the financial of a household. I guess that's a stereotype in Greece, and that's reflected in the stats we see. We do see them more active in the use of digital banking services. We see women, even younger women, much less adept in the knowledge of digital banking services, and that also opens up the discussion of how literate they are about their financial life in general, about how much they spend on their card, have they reached their card limit, which all kind of is part of the whole digital world these days. I'm just going to mention something just to kind of bring this into perspective, kind of being the practitioner in the group. I mean, we do find a lot of resistance for people to download the mobile banking app, which, by the way, you can log in only using a biometric authentication method, like your face, your finger, your voice. But people do give away their card details to a random email that doesn't exactly look like their trusted bank's email, and their bank repeatedly have told them not give away their bank details. So how can be the same person that is afraid to unlock his mobile phone with his face ID, and then at the same time he gives away his card details and his in-banking credentials? I think it comes back to what previous the previous speaker said. It's the level, the speed of digital transformation and digital enlightenment, if I say so, runs at very different speed for different demographics and different different areas in Greece. We haven't had the mentorship. We haven't had parents, teachers, the society, the state, teaching people, educating them about this use. I mean, we've shown recently, for those living in Greece, National Bank of Greece recently launched a campaign with a famous TV actress to educate older segments of the population to start using digital banking. So this is kind of the level of education we offer to our society for kind of bringing it up to speed with the latest developments. So I think for me, with this situation, this is an even distribution of digital adoption and digital enlightenment on the population will continue even further along in the following years, as long as there is not a kind of more well organized structure and institution to help mitigate this concern, whether that would be the educational system, the government, a regulatory framework that highlights the key principles for digital use. It's something up for discussion, and it's something definitely much needed, especially in seeing how fast digital transformation progresses while we're in the midst of a pandemic. Mm.
Right, we're really running out of time, but I want to bring in another, actually two questions, but one issue from the audience. That would be perhaps our last, the last question, and about the role of infrastructure. So, Giorgos Imeres, or Jorge Diaz, is asking to what extent digital backwardness in Greece is just reflecting overall physical infrastructure backwardness in the country. There's a sub-question that I'm not going to take. So is it exceptionally unusual given the other problems of infrastructure in the country? Is digital infrastructure more of a problem than other infrastructures in the country? And another question about the infrastructure, which has to do with the degree of monopolistic or oligopolistic power, because of course, Daremas is asking, digital ecosystem relies on development of digital infrastructures. These rely on operate as oligopolies or even monopolies. What is your view on having public investment and public ownership of digital infrastructure to lessen also the dependency of citizens on oligopolistic markets? Perhaps on the infrastructure issue, Effie, then Calliope, and then we'll close with Sadis. Please, 1 minute.
I'll try to keep it brief. I don't think the answer lies in the public investment. I feel that especially these areas where oligopolies are noticed, it's more about the matter of having a healthy, proper competition more than anything. That's what we've seen in countries that have very high standards on their technical infrastructure. I think definitely encouraging private investment and promoting competition in the field, I would say. Just gonna pass the floor to the rest of the speakers, conscious of the time.
Calliope?
I said, I can't say a lot about infrastructure. I'm not the most expert on that. I would say, yes, it's a matter of competition, of healthy competition between providers. And in areas that belong to, you know, to the national infrastructure, yes, maybe the state has a role. But that's all I can say about that.
Okay, we'll close with Charalambos. Charalambos, you have definitely more to say on the infrastructure, so you can take a whole minute.
I'll not focus on infrastructure. I mean, there are problems that need both investments and regulation and public policies to help speeding up infrastructures, the utilization of these infrastructures, and also the way that the whole society will be developed as a digital society. The thing is speed. I agree with Effie. Since classical thinking, since antiquity, time and speed is the biggest issue. Technology is moving so fast faster than the system of regulation, the system of justice, the system of administration, the system of enterprises, the system of banking. So we need time to prepare. We need time to prepare, especially for the senior citizens, for the people who are not equipped with skills, people who are not skillful, are not educated, and we have to keep on thinking in a systemic way. We need systemic thinking. We need to see the whole picture. For example, disinformation can destroy digital economy very easily. So we have to create digital citizenship that claim truth within the net, and we have to constantly plan better regulation and reforms within the digital landscape, reforms that will protect rights, human rights, fundamental rights, that will protect privacy, and deregulation is a very important issue, and information, informational self-determination and technological self-determination. There are many issues, and COVID-19 speeds up the framework for all these issues. We have many things to gain to synchronize with this digital revolution. Many more things to gain rather than to lose. So we have to think positive about it, but we have to create new knowledge, and we have to create new policies in order to live in a more democratic digital society.
Okay, there's many issues, as Harry, as you said, and we touched upon a few, but of course this issue of digitalization and the economy is going to be with us for all the years to come, so we'll pick up on these topics again. We have to stop here. I would like to thank you very, very much for your contributions, Professor Tsekeris, Professor Calliope Spanou, and Mrs. Effie Bitrou. Thank you very much. Thanks also to the audience. I think this is the last event of the Hellenic Observatory for the calendar year, so please join us in 2021 for more events on a variety of topics on Greece and more broadly. Thank you and good night.